One fateful day in 2004, Berkeley engineering physicist Ashot Gadgil's phone rang. It was the Office of Foreign Disaster Assistance, part of the U.S. Agency for International Development. The officer was asking for help in Africa.
And he said, literally, that the Darfur refugee women are being raped in droves as they must leave the safety of the camps to gather firewood. Can you do something about it?
Darfur is a region in western Sudan, the largest country in Africa. Since 2003, it has been the location of ongoing conflict.
Since the Darfur crisis started, I was aware of what was going on and felt terrible about it. But like most of us, I didn't think I could help.
In 2003, following a series of tribal and political uprisings, the Sudanese government sanctioned violent militias called the Janjaweed to destroy entire villages in Darfur. Since then, a brutal campaign has targeted civilians, killing more than 400,000 people and fundamentally altering their way of life. More than a decade after the beginning of the conflict, 1.4 million people still live in refugee camps. Traditionally, the women gather and sell wood for cooking, but the camps were densely packed, and by the time Gadgil received the call, fuel wood had already become scarce. Women were forced to travel far outside the camps, often walking for up to 7 hours to find wood. Any encounter with the Janjaweed militiamen almost certainly would result in rape.
About 20% of the camp residents are men, but if the men get caught outside, they are killed. It's a horrible choice.
So what could a physicist in Berkeley, California possibly do to help Darfuri refugees? Well, when Gadgil learned that the women cook by placing a round pot on a 3-stone fire, he knew that it was possible to engineer some relief.
3-stone fire is the least efficient way to take energy from the fuel wood and turn it into heat into the pot. Typical 3-stone fire efficiency is 5 to 6%. There is poor combustion, chemical energy doesn't go into heat, and there is poor heat transfer. That means that heat doesn't go into the pot. So I figured one should be able to design a stove that should be cheap, should work with their pots, with their fuel, with their cooking style, and something that should be at least 25-30% efficient. That's a fourfold in gain in their efficiency. And that means instead of going out every other day, they would go out once a week.
In 2005, Gadgil led a fact-finding team into the heart of the conflict. What they learned there from talking with Sudanese women and their families laid the foundation for designing a better cook stove.
Five things go into determine efficiency of a stove in the real world. It's not just the stove by itself. Get the cook to tend the fire right. Make sure that you understand what kind of cooking is going on in what kind of pot. Make sure the pot fits well over the stove and oxygen supply is controlled but adequate. And make sure all of that works with the right kind of fuel that's available locally.
All these variables had to be taken into account as designs were tested. After months, they finally had a functioning prototype. But a prototype isn't a product until it can be manufactured in a realistic way. Enter Ken Chow.
When I heard about Dr. Ashot Gadgil and the Darfur Stoves Project, it seemed like a really good match because in addition to being a volunteer with Engineers Without Borders, I'm also a mechanical engineer here at Lawrence Berkeley National Lab.
It would be Chow's job to determine how the stove could be mass-produced in Darfur. Depending on the availability of materials and tools, they'd either be manufactured from scratch or assembled from pre-cut metal patterns called flat packs. But both methods would require a nuanced understanding of resources in Darfur.
This pile of wood represents the amount of wood needed to cook a full meal for a family of seven using a 3-stone fire. This pile of wood represents the amount of fuel wood needed to cook the same meal for the same size family in the same pot, but with a Berkeley Darfur stove.
The team finalized the design in 2009. Since the project began, nearly 40,000 stoves have been distributed to refugees. But that's only 10% of what is needed by people in the camps. The Stove Project is now headed by Potential Energy, a nonprofit. Although the stoves are distributed for free, it costs the group about $20 to make a kit from start to finish. The kits are assembled in Darfur in a workshop operated by camp residents. More than a quarter of the stoves are sold to nearby villagers, bringing steady money back into the camp economy. About 70% of the stoves are in regular use. That means the women have taken fewer dangerous trips outside the camps and save more money on fuel. But fuel efficiency isn't the only problem with traditional cook stoves, and the problems aren't unique to Darfur. 3 billion people in Asia, Africa, and Latin America still use stoves that burn wood, coal, animal dung, and other materials to prepare their meals. Every year, about 4 million people, mostly women and babies, die from diseases related to smoke inhalation from these fires. In 2013, the U.S. Department of Energy came to Gadgil with a new challenge: design an affordable, efficient wood-burning stove that produces one-tenth the pollution of a traditional three-stone fire. Today, Gadgil heads one of the most advanced stove testing labs in the world and is well on the way to achieving the goal of a clean-burning cook stove. Next year, he hopes to begin training engineers from around the world to operate similar labs in their countries.
This project gives me one more reaffirmation that use of modern science and engineering technology can go very far in solving desperate problems of people who are at the very bottom of the economic pyramid.